Everybody's a dreamer. Everybody's a star. Everybody's in showbiz. It doesn't matter who you are. There are stars in every city, in every house and on every street. And if you walk down Hollywood Boulevard, their names are written in concrete.
It's that time of year again. While we will not be strolling the streets of Hollywood Boulevard or Annapolis, we can get our pod together and enjoy 10 days of the 9th Annual Annapolis Film Festival. It is virtual this year, and we will be talking to the movers and shakers and those that make it all happen. The Annapolis Film Festival, April 8th through 18th. Tickets and more at AnnapolisFilmFestival.org. Because she wanted to be alone. You can see all the stars as you walk down Hollywood Boulevard. Some that you recognize and that you hardly even heard of.
Joining us on the phone today is Zach Carver, who is the director of a movie that is going to be premiering at the Annapolis Film Festival, as well as one of the producers. The film is called The Race to Alaska, and it will be available April 11th at 4 p.m. through April 18th at 11:45 p.m. And I got to tell you, this movie looks hysterical. Zach, welcome, and thank you very much for spending some time with us today.
Thanks for having me.
Race to Alaska, tell us a little bit about it. I mean, I've seen the trailer, and I'm like, okay, this is there's got to be a great story on how this whole race, and it is a documentary, okay? So this is a real thing. This isn't like some kind of something that was born out of your mind in some bar on the West Coast or something some night, right?
But the race, I think, the race was. It's been called the, you know, like one of the best bad ideas around. It was born over beers with a bunch of sailors and like adventure sailors kind of deciding what would be a great challenge in the Pacific Northwest. And then Jake Beattie, the founder of the race, as they were throwing around different 100-mile or smaller races, he was like, Alaska, what about Alaska? And so, yeah, it was this big challenge of racing engineless boats unsupported from Washington State to Ketchikan, Alaska.
Okay, so this is engineless. I mean, this is similar to we have down here in Annapolis, the Key School does a thing every year. It's called the cardboard boat races. And they give you like a roll of duct tape, some glue, cardboard, and you can do and strings or something like that. And you've got to figure out a way to make a sailboat that will actually go. I mean, it's certainly not 750 miles like it is in Alaska. But this is, you know, any motorless vessel?
Correct. Any motorless vessel. As long as there's not a motor on board, you are good to go.
Presumably, this is a sailboat type of a race. The sailboats are going to win.
Yes, it is definitely possible for a human-powered boat to win, but so far we haven't seen that. One of the interesting things about the race is in the Pacific Northwest in the summer, that time of year, the weather's really variable. So there can be these high pressures that will come in and sit, and they're like a big bubble, and there can be just zero wind for days. And the founders of the race originally thought, yeah, maybe a big, long outrigger canoe or something could make enough progress on the sailboats. But it turns out sailboats are very fast now. Any ground achieved by the human power with like one or two windy days will quickly be overtaken by the sailboats.
Well, where did this start? Where did the race explain the race? Basically, you said it's okay. 750 miles.
So at 750 miles, it starts in Port Townsend, Washington, and goes up the Inside Passage to Ketchikan, Alaska, which is the first town in southeast Alaska. There's two waypoints only on the race. One is a tidal rapids called Seymour Narrows, which is a very narrow stretch of water on the east side of Vancouver Island, where the current can run up to 15 knots, like 15, 16 miles an hour, and it switches direction with the tides. So there's this basically a river rapids you have to sail through. And then there's another, the town of Bella Bella, which is about the halfway point further up the coast. So the racers stay on the inside route because theoretically to get from Washington State to Alaska, you could just go out into the Pacific and go north. But
right.
These waypoints force you inside the islands, which creates a lot of navigational challenges and current challenges and really interesting racing in narrow waterways. And of course, it's engineless. and unsupported, meaning that you cannot have any pre-planned support. You can't have someone stash your meals or like a spare part for your boat, but anything available to everyone is available to anyone. So like you can go to the grocery store if you run out of food.
Wow. Now, how long has this race been going on? How many years?
They've started in 2015. The last one was in 2019, and I suspect the next one will be in 2022.
Well, that's fantastic. Well, how did you snip this out for a documentary? I mean, are you a documentary filmmaker?
I'm a filmmaker by training. I'm more of a narrative filmmaker, but I was hired in the very first year of the race to make their promo video for just like to get the word out about this thing. And I used to work for the founder, Jake Beattie, at the Center for Wooden Boats, teaching sailing and maritime history. So I had a link to the race itself. And then they anointed me the title Film Boss, because the guy that runs the race is called the Race Boss. For some reason, everybody's a boss. And then I basically documented it from the start. So the first year, I thought, there's a story here. This is historic. And tried to film it with the scope of a feature doc, and then kind of wandered away from that for a couple of years. But kept amassing all this footage. And towards later races, I realized there's the way to make this a feature film and an experience and a big story is to make the race itself the protagonist. And so that's where we came up with the concept of intercutting from year to year as the teams go up the race course.
Okay, interesting. Well, I mean, I know in the trailer that I watched on the Annapolis Film Festival that, I mean, it looks pretty hysterical. I mean, there are some characters that are racing in this race, aren't there?
Oh, my God. It's magnetic to characters. It takes a certain, especially in the first year, it takes a certain kind of experimental demeanor to want to participate. And a lot of people call it type 2 fun. It's the kind of fun that's fun later and possibly miserable in the moment. There's a lot of characters that show up, push themselves. I mean, they're all serious competitors in their own way, but they typically have a sense of humor. And I think a lot of people the film's a lot funnier than a lot of people would imagine, actually, for a documentary.
Well, I've got to imagine. I mean, I get the serious sailors and the serious boats with the foils and everything else. And I know, you know, we've got plenty of sailing down here in Annapolis, and they take it so seriously. to turn around and all of a sudden be doing the Whitbread race, which is, that's not the name of it now, but, you know, a big race, and all of a sudden there's an outrigger canoe in there. Well, The rules don't specifically say I can't. So, you know, just the fact that I don't have a sail doesn't mean that I can't, you know, this has got to be hysterical. And I mean, it's winning plenty of awards. I know you've, I'm just looking at the list that, you know, the Big Sky Documentary Festival, the Vancouver International Film Festival, that makes sense. The Audience Award at Cape Town and Woods Hole over here and the Newport Beach Film Festival over here at on the East Coast. So, I mean, it's being very well received.
Yeah, people seem to be enjoying it, which makes me happy. We got one in-person screening, and it was the Big Sky Film Festival, which was our first screening in February last year, and it felt great to actually see it in a packed theater. There's a lot of laughs. There's a lot of great audience response. And so I have to imagine that people at home are having similar responses over this past year.
Yeah. Well, I mean, I wish we could be in person here, because this is, you know, just from the footage I saw in the trailer, it seems like this is probably a film that really lends itself to, too late for this now, but to IMAX or to certainly the big screen. But I mean, the photography looks absolutely spectacular there. I mean, how difficult was it to film this? I mean, it seems to be the filming of this thing and capturing this seems to be just almost as harsh as racing in it.
Yeah, we've had our shooters go through a lot, which is awesome. They seem to have a good time. We've had all kinds of different boats that are chasing the fleet up the Northwest coast. And it's difficult because there's no, you know, we have the two waypoints, so we know boats will go there. So that's one place, you know, you can catch people. But otherwise, you're following the tracker and you have to make a lot of choices about, like, what team is going where and what's going to be interesting. Sometimes the boats are faster than we can catch them. We've had volunteer airplanes, volunteer helicopters, drones were a real game changer in the last few years. But the thing that's been so vital to the film and to the documenting process is the racers themselves. More and more, we encourage people to just film themselves and document their experience. And that's really what gives us like the window into the moment by moment happenings of the race.
Okay, so that's, you've got some guy that's got a GoPro up on his bow or up on the mast or something like that as well, that's giving that information to you?
Yeah, and more I encourage the racers to like journal, do stuff, you know, bring the camera out at night, bring the camera out when it's boring, talk to each other, ask questions. Like I had to get, because we had very low budget, there was no possible way for me to put crews on very many boats at once. So
that's called dead weight there, Zach.
Exactly.
This is serious racing here. We're not going to take somebody with a camera on here. You're not pulling your weight. You're not sailing with us.
Exactly. So, and yeah, they are really light boats. We also did some really fun things with like moving interviews where we would have a little microphone pack in a dry bag that we would throw over to the boat and then just cruise along in the powerboat next to the racers and just do an interview while they're underway so they didn't have to interrupt their race.
And that's kind of cool. So it's sort of like the Kentucky Derby where the outrider rides up and jams a microphone onto the jockey and as they go, sort of rubs it in a little bit too as you're out there in your power boat and
I know. We've had some funny stories of people, like especially in the smaller boats, you know, they have this very solo experience. They might not see someone for a couple of days but we have them on the tracker, so we'll be motoring down some remote channel up on Calvert Island or something, and someone pops out all scraggly from their boat, like, what was coming to see us, you know? And then we'll do this interview and go edit it in a fishing lodge somewhere.
Oh, that's fine. Now, how long does it typically take for this race? I mean, obviously everybody doesn't come at the same time, but I mean, I have no concept of sailing. So I'm 750 miles out off of the coast of Alaska. I mean, how long does that take to do?
The world record is by Mad Dog Racing in 2016, and they did it in just a little under 4 days.
Okay, so this is pretty brutal.
It's pretty brutal, and then the race closes after 20 days now. So if you don't make it in 20 days, and a lot of the smaller boats that are doing it more, I liken it to a marathon a lot. Like there's a lot of people. There's like only a handful of people enter a marathon expecting to win it, but a large amount of people want to just prove to themselves they can do it. So there's a lot of people that'll go in a kayak or a smaller row sailboat, and they might take 15 to 20 days.
Okay, that makes sense. That makes sense a lot there. So we're speaking with Zach Carver, who's the producer and a director for The Race to Alaska, which will be premiering at the Annapolis Film Festival coming up. It's first available streaming April 11th at 4 p.m., and you can get it anytime through April 18th at 11:45 p.m. And if you are a sailor of any means, this has got to be something fun to definitely see and see how it is. What is I meant to ask you, what is the prize on this? What's the end result when you get to the finish line?
$10,000 nailed to a log.
Are you talking literally?
Yes, literally.
Cash,
$10,000 cash handed over at the finish line. That was actually a big deal. Most races don't really have a purse like this. And so they really wanted to like bring people out of the woodwork to roll the dice on it.
So there's
second prize is a set of steak knives, and third place, nothing. So
what are the steak knives? Are they good?
They're I think they're middle of the road. They have our Race to Alaska logo etched on them, and
so sounds like they got a $10,100 budget for prize money on this thing.
Pretty much, yeah.
That's fantastic. So it's literally $10,000 in cash. I mean, there's no trophy involved in this.
No trophy. I mean, just making it to the end is a pretty big deal. It's about a 50% success rate.
Oh, wow.
So people come back sometimes 2-3 years in a row to make it to the end once. And
how do they pull somebody out? They just have the boats that are out there keeping monitoring them, and they can radio in and say, okay, I give up.
Yeah, they basically radio in and say they're done. But it's really up to the racers to find their own way home. It's especially the further north you get. Basically, the area between the north end of Vancouver Island And Southeast Alaska is probably one of the most remote areas of coastline in North America. There's no roads in from the interior past Bella Bella, and not actually Bella Bella. It's the road goes into this like inlet that's like 25 miles in at Bella Coola. So there's just huge mountains and very few towns. So getting home can even be a challenge once they get past a certain point. It's weird. And covering it, one of the big challenges is like you can't fly north. Like even though you're closer to Alaska, there's no air travel between those remote towns and Alaska. So you have to go back. So we'll be out in the middle of nowhere and then fly back to Vancouver or Seattle and then fly north to Ketchikan. It's an interesting.
You can't get like a seaplane or anything like that, or I guess there's no real scheduled things that could get people.
There's no scheduled things. Yeah, there. You could charter a seaplane, but even that, the distance is pretty far. It'd be like 300-mile jaunt in a seaplane.
That's true. That's true. You don't think of all this stuff. This sounds funny. Who was your funniest character that you ran into in this when you were doing this? I mean, who was the character in the film that we need to keep an eye out that just that's a unique individual?
I mean, they're all fantastic. And I have a lot of, you know, I've gotten to know these people pretty well. I have a lot of love for them, but, you know, there's a lot of people really respond. There was a man that did it on a stand-up paddleboard named Carl Kruger. He's a pretty impressive person, although he's not the funniest, but he's sort of mind blowing. There's a woman named Katie Stewart that always cracks me up. She's done it four times and, she's just got a great attitude. And then there's a wonderful kid. There's a team called Bunny Whaler that did it on what they called maximum estimated schedule. And so they really took their time, but also did it in a really small boat. And they're just really affable guys. And I don't know. All the teams are a lot of fun. There's a lot of fascinating individuals.
Where are they coming from? Are they mostly from the West Coast? Or are they from all over? Or is this an international type of an attraction?
I think the furthest anyone's come is from Australia, but we also mostly from the Pacific Northwest, but a bunch of North American sailors, a bunch of Californians. The Bird Brothers, who won it 2017, are from Massachusetts. One of them is on the America's Cup team right now. There's a team Lightboat is from Grenoble in France. And did it solo one year and then did it with a partner another year. So people come from all over the world. It's pretty cool.
That's wild. And this gets underway in the summertime, you said, right?
Yes. It's always on an ebb tide. The start is at 5 a.m. on an ebb tide in June.
So, that's the official start date, right?
Yeah. So they pick.
Of course it is.
It changes a week or two every year, but they want to have long days, and then they want it to be on that shoulder season where the weather is unpredictable.
The Race for Alaska, it's a documentary. It's an hour and a half long. It's actually 98 minutes long, if you want to hold me to the thing. available at the Annapolis Film Festival, which is annapolisfilmfestival.org, April 11th at 4 p.m., and it will be available to stream at your leisure through April 18th at 11:45 p.m., and again, we're speaking with Zach Carver, who is the director and one of the producers on the film. And what else are you working on yourself? You said you primarily are not a documentary filmmaker, right?
I was trained in narrative in grad school, and I'm developing a couple narrative feature scripts. We're working on a hybrid doc comedy that involves like interviewing real people alongside of fictional characters. It's like a political comedy. And then we have, we also have like an adventure series we're working on. And that stand up paddleboarder who did the Race to Alaska he's planning to do the Northwest Passage in 2022. So we're trying to put a crew together to document that.
On a stand up.
Yeah.
Boy, I'll tell you, doing a stand up on the, that interior passage would be interesting to see how that comes out.
Yeah. I think it's going to be quite an adventure. You know, he's got 1,900 miles, ice, and polar bears. So those, I think, will add some complications to his trip.
to say the least.
To say the least. But if anyone can do it, he can. So far, he's the first and only person to finish the Race to Alaska on a stand-up paddleboard. So I feel like he's got the chops. And yeah, I don't know. We're trying to keep busy. It's such an interesting thing with film where you develop concepts, but you also have to connect with financing and partners and everything. So we'll see which ones sink and which ones swim.
It's not an easy thing to do. I know. Now I've talked to a couple other directors and they say that they've got a million films in their brain that just little snippets and thoughts and ideas. Is that how you operate too?
Yeah, 100%.
So, you know, in 3 years from now you can say, oh, you know, cripes, I remember back in 2021 that I was thinking that, yeah, okay, let's see if we can, and it's just, you might have just a little snippet and then just build on that.
Yeah. You never know. A lot of it has to do with for me at least, like the momentum you get through partners that get involved. You know, you have film is incredibly collaborative and takes a ton of hands to create. So finding people that gel with that idea and want to propel it forward, for me is a big way where they move forward. So yeah, I'll sometimes be discussing some shred of an idea. And if someone latches and gets excited, oh, maybe we have a partner, maybe we can do something.
You know, that's exciting when you find somebody in any endeavor that gets into your mindset and can sit there and say, oh yeah, this, and you get excited and you know that you're both working together on the same thing. That's exciting when it works in any kind of business, whether it be making movies or doing graphic design or whatever it may be.
It's awesome. I mean, like this film wouldn't have happened without my producers. They were spectacular and they really saw the potential and we all, you know, like we're like, this can be good. Let's make this happen. So,
well, your other producers are Ian Moreland and Liv von Ulrich. Did I get that right? Ulrich?
It's close enough. Yeah. Liv von Ulrich. She's Swedish. Wow. But
okay. But so. Now, I mean, are they producing other films? I mean, is that their...
Yeah. Liv put together, she's done like a narrative horror film before, and she got interested in The Race to Alaska because she started doing like adventure photography. And like she was riding her motorcycle around and shooting pictures. And so she came up to shoot stills and fell in love with The Race to Alaska. And then Ian, he's never been to Washington State, let alone Alaska, but and I have been producing other projects together. And he managed a lot of the sort of fundraising and post-production side of things. But it was a good team, you know?
Sounds like it. How tough is it to edit something like this? Is that something horribly crazy difficult?
I mean, we started with over 70,000 unique video clips, over 5 years of documenting. So it's a mammoth task. And we had a pretty awesome
editor. 70,000?
Yeah.
So this is maybe a half hour piece here and a 30 second piece there?
Exactly.
Holy mackerel.
Yeah, the footage adds up fast, especially when you have all these teams filming themselves. And then we did interviews on top of that, where we had over 1,000 pages of transcripts to read. Greg did just a spectacular job of understanding what could be done with the material and navigating that material. So he's a co-writer on the film, and it's always just really cool to see what we were able to do.
And that's Greg King, your editor. Mm-hmm. Did he get paid the big bucks for that? I hope.
Yeah. As much as we could offer.
Wow. 70,000 individual clips. Oh, my gosh. That's beyond fathomable.
Yeah. So there's probably like several other versions of this film we could have made. But I'm happy that we managed to get to this one.
When you make a film, is fundraising the biggest obstacle? I mean, obviously it's critical. It's a critical obstacle.
I used to think it was the biggest obstacle, but I now think that actually creating really it's like story and communicating the vision. Like it's completely related to fundraising, but I don't think fundraising is as hard when you really have a project that people can believe in. So I think a lot of people go out too early or kind of expect others to understand innately what they're trying to do. And so I do think like refining the story, refining the script, refining the pitch. is in many ways the hardest part, like figuring out how to like laser it into other people's minds. Because once it's in someone else's mind, they're much more apt to fund it.
Sure. That makes sense. I mean, I've done a number of times I'm talking to somebody trying to explain something I'm thinking. I'm going, you know, I know I've got a bunch of crap in my mouth and it's not coming. You know, what I am saying has nothing to do with what I am thinking. And,
right.
You know, and the thought is impure, impartial, and it's just not complete. And, you know, when you have a complete thought, when you have a pitch, you know, you're going to say, hey, I've got this great movie, The Race to Alaska, and so on and so forth. And I mean, if you get somebody that's, you know, looking to fund some films and stuff like that, that this just doesn't excite them. I mean, there's nothing you're going to do to really excite them.
Right.
But the couple of people that you do get, I mean, you know, you might get, you know, Malcolm Forbes, if he was still alive or something, is this big adventurer type thing, or certainly Richard Branson. He'd be like, mm-hmm. Oh, hell yeah, here's my checkbook. Unfortunately, I don't have his number, otherwise I'd give it to you. But
yeah, please, if you find that.
But Zach Carver, thank you very much for your time. Again, I encourage everybody to check this film out. It is The Race to Alaska. It is a documentary about, I'm going to say it's probably the most unusual, and I don't even want to say sailing race, but one of the unusual water races that you're going to ever witness. It is premiering at the Annapolis Film Festival on April 11th at 4 p.m. And you can watch it anytime between then and April 18th at 11:45, AnnapolisFilmFestival.org. And again, Zach Carver, who is the producer and director of the film, thank you very much for your time today.
Thanks for having me.
Everybody's a dreamer. Everybody's a star. Everybody's in showbiz. It doesn't matter who you are. There are stars in every city, in every house and on every street. And if you walk down Hollywood Boulevard, their names are written in concrete. Don't step on Greta Garbo as you walk down the boulevard. She looks so weak and fragile, that's why she tried to be so hard. But they turned her into a princess, and they sat her on a throne. But she turned her back on stardom because she wanted to be alone. You can see all the stars as you walk down Hollywood Boulevard. Some that you recognize and that you hardly even heard of. People who worked and suffered and struggled for fame. Some who succeeded and some who suffered in vain. Rudolph Valentino looks very much alike, and he looks up ladies' dresses as they sadly pass him by. But please don't tread on dearest Marilyn, 'cause she's not very tough. She should have been made of iron or steel, but she was only made of flesh and blood. You can see all the stars as you walk down Hollywood Boulevard. Some that you recognize and that you hardly even heard of. People who worked and suffered and struggled for fame. Succeeded and some have suffered in vain. I wish my life was a non-stop.
More than 100 films, from documentaries to features to shorts. Those made in Malta to those made in Maryland. The Annapolis Film Festival has something for everyone. Passes and tickets available now at AnnapolisFilmFestival.org.
Never feel any pain. And celluloid.